Maybe this is on too. It is. Wonderful. Welcome, everybody. Hanna Kokko is a guest of Athena Ectyptis and Carlo Maley this week. But unfortunately, Athena was delayed and asked me to do an introduction, which means that my very spontaneous introduction will be even shorter than usual. But we are especially delighted to have Hanna here. I've seen her several times at various conferences and at Michigan and had wonderful conversations over the years. She tackles some of the very big questions and tries to do it in a way with new angles. In particular, I followed her work on the evolution of sex itself very closely, and I'm very curious to see what she has to say about that. Today she's going to be talking about cancer. She did her original work in Finland. She spent time at Cambridge and several other places in the way, but for the last two or three years she's been at the University of Zurich, which, by the way, is the place in Zurich that has one of the best evolution and medicine programs, which she is somewhat affiliated with. I'm also going to mention very briefly that we will have a talk by a scientist about homologs and genomics and pregnancy on Monday. If you're on our list, you should get that information. It'll also be a chalk talk, so look for that, and please join us for that. I think that's all I'll say for right now, except we're so glad you're here, Hanna. Carry on.
All right. Okay, really nice to be here. This is not the royal we, there's a new PhD student in my lab who managed to spend something like 5 days doing her PhD before I told her that, you know, let's go to Arizona to meet people who are very relevant. So therefore, we have really enjoyed this visit enormously, both for the fun aspects and also for the scientific discussions here. It's been extremely inspiring. And here, well, that's not my name, that's Dawkins. When you study evolutionary ecology, you of course at some point realize that you have to read his works, including his new autobiography. And I use that as a title slide here because he says something quite interesting about his early career, which is that he was doing his studies during an era when psychologists were using things like rats and pigeons basically as models of human, let's say, aggression or whatever behavior you're interested in. And they were kind of like not taking into account that species actually evolved under different selective pressures. They were just probably, they were aware of that, but they weren't particularly interested in that question. And Dawkins is describing in the very first 20, 30 pages how it was quite eye-opening to then witness the birth of behavioral ecology, where people started to take species differences as a study object of its own right, and an extremely interesting one, and we are still working on that. And it's interesting to think about how something like the medical study of cancer could maybe benefit from a similar shift in attitude. So we all know that we use things like mouse models, things like that. We put human cancers into these things. We look at, I mean, I'm actually not an expert on these kind of things, so I don't even know how many papers have been published where we use mice or rats or things like that to figure out how cancer works. But the sort of underlying assumption there is that it's kind of the same thing as in humans. They're both mammals, so surely it's an assumption that's to some extent right. But that's an insight that I would like to talk about. But there's also another one, which is kind of like the flip side of this arrow, which is that if you think about the life of a mouse in the wild, and if you're an evolutionary ecologist, then you think that, okay, this is the threat. You're going to die at some point, and it's the owl that's going to catch you, so you're interested in sources of mortality that can include parasites, that can include predation, things like that. But you never see ecologists really discussing cancer as a cause of mortality in these things. And I'm saying that, you know, maybe sometimes they should. And it's quite a simple thought experiment that let's imagine that you're a mouse that for whatever reason is starting to develop a tumor there. You're probably not going to be the fastest running mouse if you start feeling a little bit sick. So the predator is going to catch you instead of your neighbor who is still fit. It doesn't get categorized as a cancer-caused death, of course. But it leads to this maybe biased assumption that cancer is never a problem in the wild. So a bit more on the kind of like thoughts that one might naively have before moving on to how we maybe should be thinking about these things. So if you ask a layperson, and until recently, and maybe still now, I'm I'm a bit of a layperson when it comes to actual cancer biology. But the idea is that, you know, something goes wrong in the environment. You know, you have been eating the wrong kind of things, or maybe you have experienced a bit too much radiation, and therefore your cell lineages start behaving badly. And if you think, how long has this problem been plaguing us? You might say that, well, early on, what actually killed you was a situation maybe like this, or this is childbirth. If you're a woman, then maybe hunting mortality wasn't so high. But for some reason or another, you live such short lives that cancer wasn't really a cause to be concerned about. And it's only the modern lifestyle that has led to this. So it's interesting to look at how long ago have we actually been writing about cancer as a phenomenon. And this is, as far as I'm aware, the oldest known description of cancer is the Edwin Smith papyrus, which dates from approximately 3000 BC. It's a copy of a part of an Egyptian text, which is mostly about trauma surgery. But there are actually 8 cases where people have attempted to remove tumors. And they were removed with a fire drill. I don't know what a fire drill really is, and I kind of don't want to know. But it's kind of like, laconically, the writing says about the disease that, you know, this basically doesn't work. There is no treatment. So people have certainly been aware of that for a while. There's also, I just mentioned this just to show you a little bit of the diversity of cancer across life. This is kind of like a bit of a gory example. But in January 2013, there was a 40-year-old man. He went to a hospital and he said that there's all kinds of things that feel a bit wrong. And his body was riddled with tumors. That, of course, happens in life. But in this case, there was something quite odd about these tumors. They were cancer-like cells, but they were really small. They were about 1/10 of the size that you would expect. And they had a tendency to fuse together and so on. They just sort of looked a little bit weird. And turns out that they were tapeworm cells. So this guy who was, he was also HIV positive. I think he was unlucky in very many ways, but that was relevant here because he also had a tapeworm and the tapeworm got cancer that then ended up spreading through the guy's body. And our immune system, normally you should be able to deal with these kind of things, but if you're immune compromised because of your HIV as well, then this kind of thing can start invading. Speaking of these things that can start invading when they come from a different organism, here's a bit more sort of diversity of this phenomenon. So here's 3 pictures, some of them a bit prettier than others. And the theme here, how many of you can guess what I'm talking about here? How knowledgeable are you? There's a few hands, yes. And it might be a bit helped if I say that this is a clam. Based dish, and this is actually the clam that we tend to eat. So these are all examples where a tumor has turned out to be transmissible across individuals. This is a problem that we normally don't have to worry about. If we go and visit our ill grandmother in the hospital, we don't have to worry that we get the same cancer as she does. But the first one is the canine transmissible venereal tumor, which isn't actually particularly deadly. It grows very slowly, it looks very ugly, but has been in these populations for quite a while. There's some very interesting molecular ecology on how long dogs have had this. There's a much more recently discovered example of leukemia in clams, which is killing these things much more, I think I said that already, much more quickly. And it was discovered recently by virtue of genotyping these cells and realizing that they all they are much more related to each other if you take them from different individuals than normal cells in these bodies. So somehow they must be spreading, probably just through, you know, these things live close to each other. They have their respiration, their water is being pumped, and it might not even need direct physical contact to get infected by something like this. And then the really famous case, and it's kind of like a tragic thing about conservation, being dealt with quite nicely actually by the Australian government at the moment by keeping healthy individuals in zoos as a reservoir should the entire population go extinct. So this is the case of the Tasmanian devil, where relatively recently the population was initially healthy. There was an individual in which a cancer cell appeared. And it tends to be mostly concentrated in the sort of facial area. And this is a species that has an interesting behavioral system where the social system involves a lot of individuals biting each other all the time. They fight over mates, they fight over food, they fight, it looks like, just for the fun of it. And that means that the cells can very easily transmit from one individual to another, and that's where they also can start growing. And this has been a huge problem for the population, because nothing, you can build fences, you can do whatever you like, but nothing seems to stop the spread of this thing, which kills the individuals in about 6 months, which is plenty of time for them to transmit to the next ones. There are some indications that there's some evolutionary responses to this, but still, if you look at the spread of how this thing has been decimating the population, I think it's a fantastic idea that there's right now, there's already more individuals kept in captivity on the mainland, in zoos in Tasmania as well. And should the entire population go extinct, you can basically just restock the population, because the cancer will go extinct if the host does as well. But all these transmissible examples, I'm mentioning them here because it kind of, firstly, it makes you ask, why is it usually not the case that these things can jump and behave like normal parasites, that they sort of go from one individual to the next? And I guess quite a nice idea to think about there is that because we are quite used to, in an evolutionary sense, getting badly behaving cells in our bodies, and we have evolved mechanisms to try to deal with them and kill them. So it's actually no wonder that if something differs even more from our normal cells, as in being from a related or unrelated individual, a different individual, and then also being cancerous, that we seem to be already primed to deal with that quite nicely. But then this whole problem of defending against cancer, it is actually quite tricky when you think about the earlier ways in an evolutionary tree sense of how to organize your living, because there's no reason why you can't live your life like a hydra, which in the Greek and Roman mythology, it was this sort of multi-headed beast. If you chop off a head, it just grows several new ones, so it's kind of counterproductive to try to fight against it. What these things do is that they are facultatively sexual. They can reproduce sexually the way we do as well. But they don't have to do it like that. They can reproduce a little bit like vegetative growth in your strawberry plant, which is that they just start growing mini versions of themselves on the side. So this polyp, you can see that this is the adult, and then here are some cells that start forming a new individual, and you realize the more you look into life histories of these things, there's a point in time in evolution of tissue differentiation where you stop allowing this to happen. So I can't just sort of chop my hand off and expect that a new Hanna will grow out of that. At some point, it has become a very detrimental thing to do. But earlier in the lineages, this may actually be a positive thing. This is called reproduction. This is not called cancer. And if you go to the very origin of multicellularity, where these things are even less differentiated, then of course, you know, if you just sort of kick off a few cells from there, you might now have two copies of yourself rather than one in the lineage. So that's actually one of the research questions in my lab at the moment. Like, you know, at what point do you start favoring losing this ability to do budding or vegetative reproduction and so on, and go from a modular organization to a much more strict distinction of generations. But if we go back to the sort of organisms that are a bit more familiar to us, what makes cancer really interesting as a life history problem is a statement that's kind of obvious when you think about it, which is that it's kind of hard to achieve anything evolutionarily interesting without it involving cells dividing. So a chicken that produces an egg needs to have active ovaries for that. But also if you're a male, well, here the antlers, they are not doing cell divisions at the very moment, but they must have grown at some point. Also, when you have male-male competition in a lot of systems, the bigger one is the one who wins. So to develop a bigger body, you need more cell divisions than to develop a smaller body. So there might be good naturally or sexually selected reasons to do lots of stuff to grow and so on. But this comes at a cost. And evolution ecologists are... They're very good at quantifying costs, like, you know, energy consumption or maybe immunosuppression or all these kind of things that come from these manic activities. But they haven't very much thought about cancer. And the interesting thing, and the reason why, so I'm a sort of mathematically interested evolution ecologist, why this is mathematically a really interesting problem is that both the benefits, but also the costs, can be either immediate or delayed. And that makes it kind of, as a life history question, a really interesting one to try to solve. So for example, this doing stuff, you know, you activate your ovaries or you grow or your, you know, metabolic rates do stuff when you wake up in the spring from your hibernation and so on. Some of the benefits can be immediate, like if you win this fight, then you mate with the females and so on. Or you might be investing in growing, which doesn't actually give you anything yet if you're a juvenile animal, but then maybe later once the mating season happens. But the costs also, they can be either immediate or delayed. You can just sort of look at this picture and think about what kind of immediate or delayed costs there might be. So for example, these mudskippers here, they don't seem to be paying very much attention to predators around them, even though their eyes are conveniently sort of through the top. But there could also be that, you know, whatever energetic stress they are experiencing here, it pays or sort of has a cost of them having lower survival in the future because they have to recreate their energy balance. And cancer is one that, as a cost, definitely belongs to the delayed side, the kind of, like, I would say, more interesting side, because the, you know, the equations just have to be worked in a bit more detail than applying the obvious, you know, benefits have to exceed the costs. Because it was actually interesting. I was trying to Google this morning for a tobacco ad or smoking ad, and I only found negative ones, the kind of like, don't do it. So it took me quite a while to realize that I have to search for the Marlboro Man, and it makes me ask, is this even legal to show this picture anymore? I don't know. But you can see how people used to think about this, the smoking. Okay, it might kill you later, but that's the reason why we need to sort of tell these teenagers that it's such a bad idea, but they don't really care what happens to them when they're 60, because it's cool now. That's the reason why I got so attracted by this problem when people in Berlin, in this case, first started talking to me about it. So we, and when I say we, so this is work that we have done together with people like Athena and Amy and so on, who are in this room. We wanted to see how this interesting delayedness interacts with an organism's life history, when we also know that organisms differ a lot in body size. And the body size here has to be mentioned, because anybody who works on cancer across life knows that there's a thing called Peto's paradox. And so usually it's put in a way that, you know, across body sizes, the frequency of cancer or the incidence of cancer doesn't really do an increase, even though you might predict from first principles that bigger things have more cancer because they have more cell divisions. And if every cell division is equally dangerous, you would expect more cancer in the bigger things. But this doesn't seem to be the case, so it's a paradox. So my favorite way of putting it is actually that if all else is equal, then you actually wouldn't get the big things in the first place, because they would just be dead before they ever reach maturity. And just because sometimes it's fun to talk about how the pictures are from, it's easy to find a picture of a mouse that's very representative, and elephant is no problem. But try to find a picture of a representative human being, and whatever you put in there, people start asking, well, why is it, you know, this ethnic identity, or why is it this body size? And especially if you talk about normal body size. So this is actually a project where people are trying to sell dolls that give a realistic body image to small kids instead of the Barbie thing. So I thought that's the most normal body size that I can then put in here without offending anybody. So if you need something like 200,000 times more cells to make an elephant than a mouse, let alone, you know, start talking about whales and things like that, then you do get these paradoxical thoughts in your head. So this is Peto, who is the person after whom this paradox has been named. So I'm going to borrow some of his words, because he really wrote quite beautifully about this a couple of years ago in a special issue of Philosophical Transactions, where these things were discussed quite a bit. And he figured, he makes us think about this, that The first reason for why it's actually astonishing to find whales, this is the mouse here, is the 10 million-fold difference in body mass between the mouse and a 200-ton blue whale. But therefore, this is his words, each mouse-sized piece of blue whale tissue must in some sense be about 10 million times more cancer-proof than a mouse-sized piece of mouse tissue. But there's another aspect which he then says that this is that adds to this problem and is actually an even more kind of significant reason to be astonished, which is that the lifespan of a lab mouse is only about 2.5 years, while that of a human or a whale is about 80 years. I think whales actually can live a lot longer than that when you look at the new data on that. And this adds up in a kind of non-linear way when time goes on. So he writes, for many types of cancer, the risk of having acquired cancer by HT increases steeply with age, and for some common types of cancer, it is proportional to about the sixth power of age. Thus, it is given approximately by the formula C, which is a constant, times age to the power of six. So in order to, this is no longer his words, this is coming back to sort of my talk, to become so big, these creatures, whether you're talking about the prey here or these human predators, they must have kind of done something about their cancer risk. Otherwise, we wouldn't ever have got the evolution of these large-bodied things. And a lot of people in this room know the elephant story because they have played their part in developing it in the in recent years, is that they have been found to have 20 copies of a gene called TP53. Humans, even though we are relatively good at this cancer thing, because we must be because we live quite long, we have only one. And it's a tumor suppression gene activates when cells suffer DNA damage, produces copies of the P53 protein. So mathematically, you can then ask, when do you expect the evolution of these suppression mechanisms? Do you expect them in mouse, in humans, in elephants at the same rate? Can we actually quantify this intuition that the elephants need it more than we do? And when it comes to this sort of ages and how they relate to cancer risk, the CT to the power of six, can we actually invent or think about a mechanism that produces precisely this kind of relationship? So here's a little bit of math that's coming. So we basically just started assuming, thinking about some mechanism, it doesn't really matter what, that you can do to reduce your cancer risk. And the question is, how much does natural selection actually favor that? And here's the sort of scary part of describing the model. What happens here is that we're assuming that it takes n steps of something going wrong in a cell lineage for you to develop cancer. This is actually quite well understood, that most cancers, it's kind of like multi-hit model, that it's not enough that one little thing goes wrong, because we have already been selected to deal with that, because if we didn't deal with that, we would all die very too quickly. But then that repair mechanism can itself cause some or experience some damage, and then you might have a repair mechanism for that, and so on. And if all these steps fail, then you actually get a tumor. And let's say N is something like, you know, five or six, which is something that seems to be commonly the case. Apparently, it's much simpler for some very, very dramatic childhood cancers that can be simple mutations, but are themselves really rare. Okay, so then each of these occurs at some sort of a rate. They might be different rates. Some of the flaws might arise a bit more easily than others. So this is, if you don't have an additional mechanism to reduce this risk. But you might, here we go to the kind of like, let's assume that there's some sort of new evolutionary innovation, like getting extra copies of that tumor suppression gene or something like that. And if you have that, then you're lucky because this particular rate gets reduced by a factor of D. What this is exactly, what this D means, when you write your paper about this, you have to specify it. It doesn't, for the model, it doesn't really matter. It could be, for example, that you become more efficient at repairing your DNA, so that half of the mutations actually end up sort of proceeding to the next step compared to the baseline. Or it could be that you're more immunocompetent, so that you clear some of the infections that otherwise might have caused some instability in your cell lineages. So you get rid of the problem before it even arises. Or you know, you get more efficient at killing those precancerous cells, or whatever it is. They all have the same mathematical effect. And then we assume that this is the number of cell lineages that you need to have your adult body size, whatever it is. But all else being equal, bigger things have a higher N. Now, this is the delay aspect that makes the whole thing so interesting. Even if you don't defend against the bad things happening, they are stochastic events, they're probabilistic events, so they don't arise as soon as you are a zygote and start dividing. On the other hand, if your defense was brilliant, 100%, it never is in reality, but if it was, then you would absolutely never get cancer. So what happens then in the mathematical formulation of this problem? It's simplest to show when all these rates are equal, just because you know we are talking about any kind of defense, so there's no particular assumption in here that one of them is harder than the other. This looks like a scary thing, but if I just go through it step by step, what's happening here? This is a little bit like a radioactive atom dividing or decaying. So there's when time is zero, this whole thing becomes zero. So you this thing becomes one. So initially, there's no probability that something bad has happened yet. But the decay will start happening, a bit like the radioactivity will remove the original atoms from the world at a certain rate. But we have more than one trial here. We are trying to figure out what is the probability that the cell lineage is still healthy, or at least not yet a full tumor, because not all of these steps have happened yet. And that we get by going to the next stage here. So we have this to the power of n here. But we also have a lot of cell lineages in our body, and that's why we have to do the next power there, that is to the power of big N. So now, by now, if we were looking at only this part of the equation, we would get the probability that all of our lineages are cancer-free so far. And then 1 minus that is the probability over time that your cancer-free life is now over. So it looks a bit complicated, but when you plot it, it's a very nice, smooth sigmoidal curve. So what we have here, you can put whatever units you like here. It could be days, it could be weeks, it could be years of your life. It just has to be in the same units expressed as this rate k here. So if we put some relatively big number of cells there, if we put some rate there, and we don't defend at all against this particular type of cancer, then you realize that, well, you don't immediately start developing it, but as you get older and older and older, you will at some point reach or asymptotically reach the probability of one that the bad thing happens. So you cannot live infinitely long and hope to escape this thing. It's interesting to go back to this much simpler looking formulation that was a constant times t to the power of 6. In this case, it's 5, but it sort of doesn't matter. When we plot that, we get this dotted line here. So that is an empirically derived relationship between age and cancer. And it is, of course, when you plot it on a linear scale on the y-axis, it's kind of like an increasing thing. But if you put it on a log scale just to see a bit better how well this prediction matches with that, you realize that it's a curve that increases and then it starts slowing down, keeps slowing down. But it's an incorrect prediction at the very biggest ages because a formulation like this will always exceed 100% at some point. And thereafter, you have 200% probability of having had cancer and so on. So empirically, of course, you shouldn't extrapolate too hard. But here I would say that this mechanistically derived equation actually performs better because it predicts that you might reach something, a value close to 100%, but of course you cannot go beyond that when you look at the cell lineage-based calculations. But for the ages where it actually matters, I mean, this is where most of your life happens, The correspondence is actually astonishingly good. This was quite a satisfying thing to see. So then we can sort of look at actual insights, biological insights that you can get from this kind of model. What happens if you do invent, and if you do experience some sort of evolutionary innovation, how much do you actually benefit from it in terms of your life history? So here, what was on the y-axis is the probability that your cancer-free life is over against age. And this is the same graph that we saw earlier, but the parameter values are a bit different because I want to make it a bit of a shorter-lived animal to begin with. If there is now this innovation that has a defense value of 0.5, so kind of like 50% of everything that can go wrong in your body you deal with, and it didn't go wrong after all, then we get that curve. We get a shift even more to the right if we get a 75% efficiency of removing all these bad things. And something mathematically very pleasing about this is that if you look at these length of the arrows, you can take any point in time, any probability here, and look at the length of the arrows of how long do you have to live before you reach this high cancer incidence. The 0.5 here, this is exactly the ratio. This is the lengthening of lifespan that you got because of your defense relative to the entire length of the arrow. So the 75%, this is maybe clearest here, compared to the original, you live three times as long. So three quarters of the lifespan that you now achieve is thanks to your improved cancer defenses. And that applies horizontally wherever you put this. But absolutely speaking, you know, at the highest incidences, that's where you get the biggest improvement, which means that all else being equal, you would get the biggest benefit, i.e. the longest extension of healthy life at the oldest ages, without actually improving the cancer defenses age-dependently. It's just a demographic conclusion that happens here. But not all else is equal across life. Namely, if we come back to the mouse, and we come back to how much it can actually could benefit if it suddenly started having these elephant copies in its genome, making it really, really cancer resistant. So let's say that we had this hypothetical mouse that suddenly lives 85 years long, in principle, if it didn't die from other causes. It wouldn't actually matter for a mouse life history in the wild at all, because in reality, they don't really live much beyond one reproductive season, because these kind of things still surround them. And that can be quantified. So that's what we wanted to put in the model to make it really applicable to what has evolved in nature. So we wanted to have extrinsic mortality in the model, and to be able to contrast this, we just put a constant rate of death, mu, in the model. It's basically kind of like owl abundance. That's the way you can think about this. How many other things can exist in your environment that can kill you? And this is what it looks like. So this is now the probability that you're still alive considering this extrinsic risk only. So for a moment, we forget all cancer thoughts. We just ask, is our mouse still alive? Because it hasn't yet been caught by an owl. So if mortality is high, then this is again a bit like a radioactive decay. This is the probability that you still see the mouse running around when it's 20 units old. When this mortality is low, this is the same shape, but it just takes much longer to reach low levels. So the next thing to do is then to multiply this extrinsic probability of being still alive with the probability that you're still also alive because you have avoided cancer. And when you do this, you finally end up with something publishable. So this is the Amy's paper, where we have looked at the cancer-free lifespan now taking into account both the owls and the cancers that can end your reproductively active lifespan. And here we have these different values for the defense. So we have the, this is a dashed line because that can actually never be achieved. We cannot really get such good defense mechanisms that nothing would ever, ever, ever go wrong in all these cell lineages. But it's kind of like the hypothetical best case scenario. And here, on the other hand, is what you get if, as a lifespan, if you don't really care particularly much about your cells doing funny stuff. And what's on the x-axis is extrinsic mortality on a log scale. So here it's very high, so we have extremely short-lived animals, they don't achieve much lifespan at all. Here it's extremely low, and therefore in principle you could live almost forever if you were following this line, which assumes that you never ever get cancer. But the problem is that you do get cancer, and therefore you can see that there is a range where defense really matters. If you move from the zero line, 0.1, 0.5 to 0.9, you really can improve your reproductively potentially active lifespan by a lot. Whereas if your extrinsic mortality is already high, you know, it doesn't really matter very much what you do there. So natural selection might not even see this improvement, even though it's a brilliant invention. All of the individuals, whether they have it or not, they reproduce about equally long. So this is another way to express this, and now focusing particularly on body size rather than the extrinsic mortality. So if we vary that, this is from another paper in the same special issue that came from this stay in Berlin. So is it really worth having this cancer defense evolving in your body? So here we have an example where this is a hypothetical creature that has this many cells, and this is the cumulative cancer risk with age. So this time, ignoring the extrinsic mortality in this figure, it will come back in that in the figure below. So this is, again, if you double the defense, we get the sort of double long arrow here. So you can see that cancer risk increases much more slowly with age. And what happens here, this is a bit of a complicated thing to read, but CEL is the probability that it's the cancer rather than the extrinsic stuff that was responsible for your life ending. So you can see that when you're young, if you die, you die from other causes. If you're much older, you are, you know, it's relatively likely with this life's history that it might be the cancer that kills you. But what's interesting then is also to plot the probability, taking into account both the extrinsic and the cancer, that you're still alive. And the little number here, which is 9.4, I don't know if you can see that, that tells you your expected lifespan, which in all these examples we have put as 10 if it's only extrinsic mortality that kills you. So you would live 10 years as a small mammal or something like that. So the probability that you're still alive, and this is now log scale, which is why it doesn't look like this. It looks like it wouldn't be completely straight if mortality was constant over age. You can see that it starts drooping a little bit towards the end because of cancer. And if you didn't have your defense, you would live, you know, 7.79. It's quite a bit shorter than the 9.4. So it probably makes sense for this organism to invest in cancer defenses, assuming it's not too costly. But then we can do the same calculation for, the only thing that's different here is that we have half the body size compared to previously. So this thing is a little bit smaller. So you can see that the curves are actually very similar, and they kind of like, it's almost hard to see a difference really. But if we do the maths when it comes to the actual lifespans predicted, well, there's still a difference, but it's 8.3 compared to 9.6. So the extra offspring that you might get from living that bit longer, it's a bit of a less of an improvement than it was previously, simply because you're a smaller body-sized animal. Or we can derive the same thing, but let's do something a bit more radical. From a four-step model for the cancer defenses, we move to a five-step model. So it's like whatever has broken your cell lineages, we now have an extra check on that. So this is kind of like a bigger mechanistically operating improvement, and that is much better than these kind of more gradual changes. It really can make this organism survive a lot longer. Cancer doesn't start increasing until much later. But at the same time, I'm kind of doing something cheeky here. I'm changing two parameters at once. This is also a very much smaller organism than either of these two. So then you have to start comparing, kind of like you think that, oh, this is such a brilliant invention, it should spread much faster. And you can see that indeed there's a big difference in how quickly you were getting cancer, how often you were getting cancer ending your life than if you do defend. But does it actually matter? You're now a small thing. And turns out that the difference is actually smallest in this example. And the reason is that it's not so clear because it's a log scale, but these curves, they stay, even if you don't defend, it stays lower than here. So therefore, all else being equal, we would say that the small things, they can be fairly relaxed about this stuff. So we can formalize that in a bit of more systematic search of what happens in the parameter stage. And this is again from the paper that we did with Michael Hochberg while in Berlin. So if you have a certain number of stem cells in your body, and this is kind of like a different way of measuring the extrinsic mortality, how long would you live if you never, ever, ever got cancer? So how long does it take until the owl catches you? And that can vary. So here's the elephants, they live very long, and here's the mice. So you can see that there really are regions here where, you know, if you develop a bigger body, it's not that costly, because you're still quite small. If you're this little and then you get a 10% bigger body, you're still quite small, and you still don't get cancer. But if you, at the same time, you could also have this another sort of competing evolution process going on in there, which is that you could develop this new extra cancer defense layer. Is that selected for? How much more fitness would you get? Up to 15% if you are really long-lived and large, that would be fantastic, but extremely little if you are short-lived anyway. So that's kind of like just a graphical summary of the things that I've been talking about here. So to something a bit new at the end, a different topic from just the body size and lifespan extrinsic mortality things. A lot of life exists in a way that we have two different sexes. And this was also something that we thought about quite a lot while we were in Berlin. And one of the big differences between males and females in a lot of organisms is that often males have more variance in their reproductive success than females. It's not a foolproof rule, but it kind of applies across a lot of systems. And there, the idea is that if a male is feeling a little bit bad for whatever reason, it's in a low condition, then this one gets much higher paternity in the population than this one here. Whereas for females, it's still true. I mean, there can be differences in reproductive success. This is slightly grayer here. It's maybe not performing quite as well or living as long as the other one. But still, both of them might have roughly the same number of offspring in any given season. It's usually these differences are milder in females than males. And there's also, I mean, of course, you have to remember that there could be all kinds of sex-specific things going on. This is probably the ugliest picture of this talk. So I'll remove it. essentially, we know, for example, if you look at all cancers in humans, there's of course tissue-specific things, you know, breast cancer and testicular cancer and so on. But males actually are more vulnerable than females. So we try to understand this kind of phenomenon as well. And we put, this is again a sort of relatively abstract parameter, competition intensity, but it basically measures the sort of winner-takes-all-ness of the system, predicted to be often greater for males than for females. And what would be the optimal investment in cancer defenses? And you can see that as competition intensity increases, this goes radically down. And what it means is that within the same species, of course, I mean, most of our genes are shared between the males and the females, but they might be expressed in different ways. And then some of them are on the sex chromosomes, which adds to the interest of this problem. But let's say that there's a new innovation that has happened in, let's say, the lineage that led to elephants. It might be that it's actually stronger selected for in females than in males, because the males would rather have this sort of life where they invest in the short-term things rather than in the delayed benefits of having a longer lifespan. And how that kind of sexual conflict is then resolved is an interesting thing. It would be fantastic if we, if we could, so this is sperm competition, which is an interesting thing because it varies depending on the social system in mammals, in birds, in a lot, you know, I can pull out fish papers if you want to. And that covariates really nicely with the size of the testes across animals. But I don't know if anybody, I mean, you would create the prediction that you might get a lot more cancers of these kind of things in organisms that must invest in a lot of sperm production simply because they try to outcompete the sperm that another male has put inside a female. But I just don't think that we have quite the resolution of the data. We have a lot of data on the sperm side, but on the cancer side, when it comes to non-human males, I think it's, the data are just a bit too anecdotal, but it would be really nice to be able to look at these predictions there. So Yamur is in the audience here, and we have spent a few really, really fun days here brainstorming about all kinds of ideas, what she is going to do in her PhD, and this is one of the ideas. So what she's thinking about at this very moment, I hope she agrees, is that when you think about a picture like this, here we have, you know, how much would it be great for your reproductive success if only you were a bit bigger, for example, as a male, or it doesn't have to be a male thing. A big fish can fit more eggs into her than a small fish if you're a female. So there could be a selection on body size, and we know that over macroevolutionary scales, time scales, things tend to become bigger. That's Cope's rule. If something like that is happening, but at the same time, there's also this thing, which is that the cancer defenses start to be more selected when you are bigger, then would you predict these things to go exactly at pace with each other? Or would you expect that there could be evolutionary lags? If you think about humans, for example, we have populations that are quite tall and we have populations that are much smaller, but these have diverged relatively recently. So it might be that you predict more cancer in some population than another, not because of the environment, but just because of the growth strategy, because we haven't really evolved to be so different in the cancer defenses. Or if you think about much longer time scale still, think about dinosaurs that led to birds. I said that things tend to become bigger over time, but that's not always true. So birds actually arose from pretty big things, but then they wanted to start to fly and they became really lightweight, and most birds around you, they are nothing like this. So if we had a look at the current existing birds, which also interestingly have very different paces of life. So this here is an albatross, lives kind of forever. This is a blue tit that reproduces, has something like 10 to 12 young every summer, but usually just lives one summer, if it's lucky. When you know that there must have been some reasonably good cancer defenses back then, otherwise we would have never got the dinosaurs going, and then nowadays you're like that, have you still inherited these fantastic traits from your evolution past, or were they so costly that you got rid of them? So we're actually planning to do some genomic scans of what is actually going on here. We do know, and this has been known for a long time, that if you take the same body-sized mammal and a similar bird, the bird tends to live longer. One of it is that they can fly, so they can kind of fly away from their predators and so on. But there could be also something interesting about how they're dealing with this kind of risk. And I think I'll just stop there. I'm sort of repeating myself, but it really has been fun to talk to these people here. I also have to thank Michael Hogberg, who is actually the reason that I got to Berlin in the first place, which led me to meet these people. And if you don't know what is this place that I'm talking about here, I think you should Google it because it's absolutely fantastic for getting new collaborations started. Kathleen is in Zurich, although she's actually starting a job in Basel now, but that's only 1 hour away. So we are planning to discuss all kinds of fun stuff with Yamura and her as well. And my own university I will also thank for funding. So thanks.
Thanks, Hanna. We would like people to use a microphone so that the recording will catch your questions.
We have about 10 minutes. Andrew Reed is from our scientific advisory board and visiting today.
Thanks. Very nice talk. Strikes me that this analysis rests on your assumption that the longevity is a good measure of fitness. So that's saying something about age-independent reproductive patterns. Mm-hmm. It's also saying something about lifetime reproductive success as a sensible measure of fitness rather than little r, which would front-load the...
Right, yeah.
So that must radically change it. And my thought is that what that will tend to do is make the argument against cancer defences even stronger.
Right, okay, so if I just comment on the lifetime reproductive success versus R thing. So this is, for those of you who are into life history theory, you know that there has been this sort of decades-long debate about which measure should you actually be using. And the little r refers to the fact that if you have an exponentially growing population, then the same number of offspring produced can lead to different fitness. If you produce them earlier, they form proportionally a bigger part of the population, and therefore you kind of get a bigger representation in the future gene pool. So therefore, it's good to get things going early. When I model things where I don't really know what type of organism I'm talking about, because I want to talk about all of them simultaneously, then I tend to actually favor the lifetime reproductive success for the reason that we don't really expect populations to be forever in the exponential growth phase. We expect there to be density dependence and things like that. And then whether you produce your young early or late is actually the same. But at the same time, there's absolutely no reason to avoid making different assumptions to see if they might matter. And if I just go back to the graph where we have the age dependencies, so basically that would say that more of your reproduction happens, or the important reproduction happens earlier, and therefore you should weigh this, how much you get out of this, by how early you are, and then I think you're right.
Now, that was really interesting. I was wondering about other evidence for that you know of for body size effects on cancer resistance, other than the P53
story. There's a lot of people here in the audience who can answer that question better than I do, because that's like, you know, their bread and butter. This is exactly what we have been talking about in the last few days, that if you look at it genomically, which we are planning to do, we have a bit of a taxonomic problem here, which is that for medical reasons, people know the mammal stuff much better than the bird stuff. So we do know that there are cancerous growth things happening in birds, but the interest in figuring out exactly what are the gene level predictors of those kind of things, the whole work hasn't really been done. But if I express it positively, then I would say that, you know, just literally yesterday we came up with the idea that, hey, we actually know people we could get some albatross blood from, and we could sort of do the same kind of experiments that have been conducted on the elephant cell lineages. We could actually do that and learn something in the process. But actually, I should also say that like the model is something where this defense, it doesn't have to be necessarily a particular allele, or it doesn't have to be a copy number. It could also be, you know, immune function to clear these infections, or, you know, whatever. So it's quite ambiguous, about open-minded about what it might be. And yeah, who knows what birds do? They're in so many ways, they are better than mammals when it comes to, you know, the whole antioxidant stuff and so on. People who study them, they're great.
I have a question that I'm going to ask in two ways. The first one is, what do all of these models say about how we could possibly live forever? And the other way I'm going to ask it is, this graph in particular shows this very cool effect you mentioned of actually increasing marginal lifespan as you increase the amount of cancer defenses. And we know that there are big differences across species in how fixed lifespan seems to be versus how variable it is. So my question is, do you think that these cancer defense dynamics could potentially explain differences across species in sort of variation in lifespan and sort of development over the course of the life?
Yeah,
of organisms?
Of course, I mean, if you go to the extreme, there are things like similar parasitic salmon that just completely die after, you know, 2 weeks after reproduction because they kind of shut down their immune systems and so on. So there, yes, there are those kind of cases. But when we have dealing with more iteroparous systems where at least in principle there's always, this is a loose word, but the sort of desire to live another year if only you can, then there still can be astonishing variation in rates of senescence. And there's quite a big research effort now trying to understand exactly why the patterns can be so divergent in different organisms. And I find that a hugely fascinating field. And of course, I mean, I would be lying if I said that it's all due to cancer, because there's all kinds of other things that start deteriorating when you get old. It's almost like if you did a 2x2 table and you kind of like, you're cancer, relatively cancer resistant or not, and all these other causes are allowing you a long lifespan or not. It's an asymmetric thing in the sense that you can only live really long time in one of the corners, so that you need to be able to deal with cancer if for other reasons you might be able to live long as well. Whereas whether or not you have those defenses, if your life is short anyway, it kind of like doesn't matter. And I find that fascinating, but I'm not sure if I'm really answering the question.
I guess just to clarify, it seems like the more cancer defenses you have according to this model, the more you have the potential to
exactly.
increase
and you start capitalizing
lifespan.
On that.
Yeah.
So it's certainly true that if you have these other, I mean, you always have to remember that there's so many trade-offs operating in a life history, that if you have other trade-offs between early and late reproduction, such as, for example, indeterminate growers are very interesting here. A really big fish can lay a lot more eggs than a small fish. So does it pay off to delay your reproduction until you're huge? That is only profitable if you haven't died from any of these causes that can kill you before you are there. So yes, the window kind of opens. Yeah, I think now I finally got it, what you said. That's cool.
We have time for one or two more if anyone would like to comment.
So what about plants?
They
live really long and they get really large?
Yeah. Actually, it's kind of interesting. Small discussion about plants is the reason I got to Berlin in the first place, but then I haven't actually. How did I end up there? I didn't end up working on them too much, but the reason Michael invited me to go to Berlin when I had published all kinds of things on life history, but I had never worked on cancer. I knew only about as much about it as anybody walking on the street. Is that he came to Australia while I was there, and we had a chat about various things, and we chatted about why plants don't get cancer, which is actually wrong. But they're relatively cancer-proof in the sense that they might get all kinds of things going, growing funny and so on, but it rarely kills the organism. And there's kind of two different reasons that are often quoted here. One is that they have cell walls, everything is in place, and they don't really have the sort of circulatory systems that, like blood in humans, that allow a bad thing to start spreading to others. So in other words, the sort of metastasis doesn't really happen in plants. They might just sort of get funny in one part of their body. And the other thing that's kind of correlated is that they are modular organisms. And if there's something that goes wrong here, you have equivalent structures elsewhere, and you can do your reproduction via most places. So just on the flight on the way here, I was actually reading a review paper on what is similar and what is different between stem cells of animals and plants. But that's actually also one of the reasons why it's so interesting to think about. I go back to the hydra picture. A thing like that here. I mean, this kind of looks like a plant. It's an animal, but it can do these sort of budding off things. And when you go to life histories that allow that, but also allow the sexual reproduction, which then goes through a zygote, I think there's a lot to learn from these things. There's also, by the way, a sort of cancer-like phenomenon reported in these ones as well, where things go funnily wrong without becoming a new individual. So there's some stuff going on there.
Great. Thank you so much, Hanna. Appreciate it.